Hello, this is New Directions for Women. We're a program produced by the Morris County Chapter in New Jersey of the National Organization for Women. My name is Marva Stark. Today we have an interesting program. We're going to be talking about gay issues, which we haven't discussed in quite some time on this show. And we have two guests tonight. Sue Harris is a longtime member of the board of the Gay Activist Alliance in Morris County. I tripped over that because I usually use the term GAMIC, but you don't know what GAMIC is. It's the Gay Activist Alliance, yes, in Morris County. It is easier. And Sue is also their past president. She's currently their vice president for operations and editor of their annual Pride Guide magazine. She is a member of the Gender Rights Advocacy Association of New Jersey and of PFLAG, which is an organization for family and friends of lesbians and gay men. Sue has been on the security team for the annual Gay Pride Parade in New Jersey, which happens every year in June in Asbury Park. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
We also have as our guest Wendy Berger. Wendy has a long and distinguished history of activism in the causes of feminism and lesbian and gay rights. She's past president of the New Jersey Lesbian and Gay Coalition. She served on Governor Whitman's transition team, for the Division of Community Affairs. She began the Family Project, which developed into the research encompassing the domestic partnership rights. And she also developed a political strategy that led to the passage of domestic relations law in New Jersey. And she was very much honored and was the second, she and her partner were the second people to register for domestic partnership in the state of New Jersey, which is great. She's a member of two congressional advisory boards for Congressman Ferguson, who's a New Jersey congressman, and she's on Governor Corzine's Commission on Human Rights. So welcome to you, too.
Hi.
Well, we talked about a number of things on the phone that we thought we'd cover tonight. Basically, we haven't discussed gay issues in a long time, so we're wondering what's really going on and what are some of the interesting things. But I had one question, and it concerns domestic partnership versus marriage, because I thought when we got domestic partnership that that was great, and although marriage, you know, was kind of a religious thing and it would be nice too, but okay, we don't have it, but we have domestic partnership. So what's the big deal? I mean, why are people so intent on marriage right now if we have domestic partnership?
Well, I think that it comes down to an issue of fairness. I mean, you could look at it in terms of how many rights you get from one to the other, and certainly in marriage you get literally thousands and thousands more rights. Domestic partnership benefits provide probably between 10 or 12 actual benefits. They're very important ones. They were things like they allowed gay couples to be each other's legal next of kin and to have legal relationships. So prior to that, if gay people were parenting a child, the parent of that child had no legal relationship. They were not legally related to each other. They were the parent of the child, but not related to each other, and couldn't provide benefits as a result of that. And that's part of why creating anything other than marriage with regard to families becomes very confusing, because you don't really have the same access to benefits and the ability to protect children and your partners as you get older if something happens.
Maybe you could answer too and be maybe a little more specific about what rights does domestic partnership provide, and then what? I know you said thousands. I don't expect you to go through thousands. But if you could give me an example of some of the rights that married people have that people who are in registered domestic partnership.
Domestic partnership provides a legal right to visit your loved one in the hospital, in the emergency room, in intensive care, where family members only are allowed to be. And before that, one partner was a legal stranger to the person in the hospital bed who they couldn't go take care of, be with in their final minutes.
Okay.
domestic partnership provides for them to be legally recognized as next of kin in that respect.
Okay.
And provides for the legal disposition of final remains?
Yes. So you give to make funeral arrangements in addition to being able to visit somebody in a hospital.
Okay, and you can adopt children together?
Not necessarily.
Oh, no, okay, because
we already had that.
Okay.
Well, we have that by court order in New Jersey, but not it's not
formalized.
Right.
It's not in the domestic partnership.
No. Okay. Right. So it doesn't actually give you anything with regard
to this. So what else with domestic partnership?
What else does it give you?
Yes.
It last will and testament. And this is actually a very big thing, because New Jersey has a very regressive state inheritance tax. So if you're a couple living together and you're not married, the state takes 17% from the first dollar of anything that you own jointly. So if you have a joint bank account, if you own a car together, if you own a home together, anything that you own, even from the smallest to the largest assets, from the very first dollar, there isn't a shelf the way there isn't like a gap the way there is with federal tax, where they don't tax, you have to have an estate under $1 million.
Yeah. Even if you can prove that you bought it together.
Right, and in fact, the state starts out by assuming that the person that died owned everything and that you have to pay tax on everything. And if you can prove that you own half, then you pay tax on half. But 17% of somebody's house, so that's one of the largest values in terms of that kind of thing.
Okay.
And access to medical benefits, and although it didn't mandate per se that companies give benefits through the bill, it did for state employees, and also in New Jersey, almost every Fortune 500 company doing business in New Jersey does already provide domestic partner benefits. So what it did was it created a standard criteria and it made it easier for those companies to continue to expand those benefits.
Okay.
But it doesn't actually require them.
Okay. So what are the main things now, unless you haven't covered all?
No, that is really the biggest things. And that you're legally related. I mean, that the idea that you're legal strangers becomes a very complicated thing in a variety of circumstances, not just hospitals. In a legal situation, if there's any kind of problem, the fact that you have that you're not legally related to each other means that you don't have, you can't even like travel in a an ambulance, things like that. Certain places, only your next of kin can go. And if you have no legal relationship, you don't have any access. So it's those kinds of things.
Okay. So I guess, well, what happens, let's say a couple has been together a while and there's for want of a better word,
a divorce
or breakup. What happens? I mean, is there any legal recourse with the domestic partnership?
In terms of the
legally.
Dividing the assets,
yes,
you mean?
Yes.
They didn't formalize that.
The way that it basically works is they look at it almost like a limited partnership. So anything that you acquire after you're together and that you commingle, the courts at this point are looking at and are expanding in a positive way. New Jersey courts have been great advocates and have helped in a variety of areas. And this is one of the areas that initially in divorce and in custody cases, they've been pretty aggressive about expanding and asserting those kinds of issues, so that if you're getting divorced and you have joint assets as a result of since you've been married, then that would be considered part of the relationship and could be split up. Anything that you had prior to or kept separately basically stays legally separate as a separate entity. Because you're not
married, you're domestic partners.
So you're not legally responsible for each other's debt the way that you are when you're married.
Oh.
It's one of the benefits.
So both.
It's one.
One of the benefits.
Right.
Oh, I don't know whether it's good or bad.
Right. It's but you're not legally responsible for each other's debt.
Okay. Anything else? Why it's important to have marriage, actual marriage?
Well, those are the limited things that you get with domestic partnership.
Oh, okay.
Marriage gets, there are so many more benefits. And as we said, they are really thousands of them. But
the biggest benefit is recognition. Recognition that our partnerships, families, relationships are just as meaningful as heterosexual relationships. And the love that two people have for each other is worthy of sharing with the world, having the same legal benefits and legal rights and responsibilities and obligations. We want equality of all of that.
We focus, Sue makes a really good point, which is that we tend to focus on the numerical stuff, the asset, the financial
component. That's what I was doing.
The legal pieces. But Sue's absolutely right. There's every bit the emotional, social, and cultural reasons. And actually, if you think about it, that is really what's driving this in some ways more than any of the other things. Certainly, as gay people are having children and raising children, that having legal families recognized is also a legal issue, because if you're going to have children, those children need to be protected. So there are definitely, it never gets like separated out so it's only one thing or the other. It's like people, they want it for every other reason that everybody else wants it, for all of the cultural, social, and emotional things. Because in a culture where relationships are difficult, where people are struggling to stay together, that for people to make those kind of commitments are for each and every one of the reasons that everybody else does it.
Yeah, thank you. It really set me straight on that. Yeah. If I was going to go down, I might have gotten to the thousandth one.
I mean, the big benefit things like that that you were trying to, are things like Social Security and pension. Those are the big
things. And filing tax returns.
They're all financial benefits,
right.
Yes.
Right.
But the stability of the family is the big one.
It's absolutely.
Yeah. Now, I remember something Donna Templeton said. We when you were on the show quite a while ago, and we talked about same-sex marriage at that time, was long before it was anywhere near getting so close to
a possibility.
Yeah,
right.
It wasn't a possibility. It was just a dream. And she said that any time in this society, which you're saying again, two people are willing to take responsibility for each other and care for each other and love each other, where if they didn't have each other, they wouldn't have anyone. How wonderful that is.
Right. And if they're caring for each other, they're taking the burden off of the public roles, off the society that would otherwise have to support them.
Yeah.
Having them care for each other in some way is better for society.
Right. The economics of that is very interesting, which is that actually it diminishes the role of uninsured people, because it allows people, when you allow people to access their benefits more fairly, because right now it's not just gay people, but straight people who are married, who are working, who have different access to benefits as people who are married than people who are not married. Single people, straight and gay, have less access, because basically the extended benefits that go to married couples are an additional benefit that single people aren't compensated for.
Right.
And so there's a whole compensation thing around, you know, equal pay for...
And it's not taxed. A husband provides insurance for his wife. Her insurance is not taxed. Domestic partners...
Oh, right, that's the other major...
Domestic partners provide insurance for their partner. It's taxed.
You have to
income.
Pay, right, you have to pay... Income tax on the value of the whatever the worth of the insurance is.
So the
value of the insurance policy, you have to pay tax as an additional benefit.
Yeah.
So that's one of the negative components.
Well, I think it would be nice if we had national health insurance. We wouldn't have to worry about all
that. Well,
but
that's another.
In the meantime, we don't have to worry about it.
That's another whole show.
Yeah.
Right.
We talked about when we spoke on the phone. We talked about. Two very important court decisions. One was the case of, and I hope maybe both would want to talk about this. One was the Boy Scout case, which I'm sure most people
remember.
It was a while ago. But it was a big case, and everybody knew about it, that this young man who had been an Eagle Scout and was doing all this volunteer work with the Boy Scouts, and he was gay, and the Boy Scouts didn't want him to be a Boy Scout leader because he was gay. So that's the one case. And the other was the case of the Galducci's. And
Galuccio's.
Galuccio's. Oh, boy. Okay.
It's okay.
I'd never heard of them before. And their case was also very interesting, and all the developments out of that case. Do you want to talk about the Boy Scout case?
Sure.
Okay.
From my understanding, the Boy Scouts found out that this man was gay and kicked him out, essentially. And Jim Dale took the Boy Scouts to court in New Jersey. It worked its way up through the New Jersey court system to the New Jersey Supreme Court. And the New Jersey Supreme Court ruled that, no, the Boy Scouts aren't allowed to kick him out because it's a public access...
Public accommodation issue.
Okay.
And they met mostly in schools and were therefore subsidized by schools. And that they receive, because of their relationship and the way that they meet and that they're mostly not charged, that there's actually a subsidy of the public schools.
Okay. So on those grounds, the New Jersey Supreme Court said, you can't kick him out. He has to be able to stay.
Okay.
Of course, the Boy Scouts appealed that. It went up to the United States Supreme Court, which sided with the Boy Scouts, saying that it was a private organization and they can do what they want. Mm-hmm. And the ramifications of it were that many individual Scout troops were kicked out of their accommodations because of the...
It was a backlash.
The schools or the fire department or the community town center or the town hall space where they were meeting for free said, well, we have these laws on our books that say that you can't discriminate based on all these things.
Right.
And if you do, bye-bye.
So boy, did they lose.
So they lost that.
Yeah, it was very interesting how there was all this backlash. Also, in the case, they basically made the argument that they didn't meet in public. They came to court and misrepresented what the circumstances were in order to win the case. They said that they weren't meeting in schools and that most of their meetings were in private, private places that shouldn't be covered under that. So, and they prevailed because they misrepresented that information. And that was also sort of part of...
Doesn't everybody kind of know where the Boy Scouts meet? I don't, but...
I think that they do, but I think that all these other factors became an issue. And I also think that, it's an issue, again, almost like the marriage thing. You have a time in our culture where it's hard to get people to do volunteer work, that it's hard to get people involved. And the thing about James Dale that was extraordinary was the guy that he was every day before, the hero that he was every day going to that troop and being involved in the kind of life that he lived.
And it was okay for him then.
Right. Up until the issue happened. And so he was very active and very involved. And at a time when, most organizations, volunteer organizations are, busting to get people to come in to help them, to take somebody like this and to dismiss that kind of value. And also, at a time when the Boy Scouts had an opportunity to be part of a positive way of dealing with this kind of circumstance, privately or however they chose to, but to actually turn this into something that was positive rather than a lawsuit, which wound up using up their resources, and in all those kinds of ways, the way that they managed this whole thing was perceived as being very negative. And for a very long period of time, Sue's right, they're funded through like United Funds and certain community funding, things like that, and lots of different areas, like in Somerset County. All those United Way groups pulled their funding, so they lost money across, and it was across the country. It wasn't in liberal places.
It wasn't just New Jersey.
And people mailed their kids across the country from Iowa mailed their sashes back to, and their merit badges back to the Boy Scouts. It was this whole big initial visceral reaction.
But no one heard of it.
What do you?
I mean, I didn't know about it. I mean, not that I.
It was.
I don't want to. I certainly don't know about everything, but...
It was a while ago. I think that, some of the... I think that the Boy Scouts have attempted to, recover some of their reputation a little bit. But when it was going on, it was really a big deal.
I wanted also to ask...
Right.
Okay. And the other case that was really interesting was the... Galuccios.
John and Michael Galuccio.
Yeah.
Yeah. They adopted, or they had a foster child, and they wanted to adopt the boy jointly together once, instead of going through the usual process up to that time, where one man would adopt the boy with a whole series of appointments and interviews and legal paperwork and expense. And then once that was approved and he was now the adoptive father, they'd go through the whole process all over again for the second father with the interviews and the paperwork and the whole series of expense. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. They said, we're a partnership. We should be able to adopt the boy once as partners, joint adoption.
So they won that?
So it went through the courts, and
which court was it?
It went up to the Superior Court, and
Superior Court.
It was waiting to be reviewed by the state Supreme Court, and Governor Whitman, during her first campaign, had sat down with the Coluccios and had a meeting with them and got all the briefing on the issue and became aware of it, and had said at the time that if she became governor that she would withdraw the state's objection and change the DIFAS regulation. And 18 days
It wasn't even really a regulation, it was just sort of a rule of thumb.
No. DIFAS is a regulation.
Official written.
Right, and actually that was the problem, because some people have gotten it through. And what happened was there had been people who slipped through, but it was against the actual rule. And then finally it got, you know, there was an issue about it, and they decided that they had to follow the rule. And 18 days after Governor Whitman was inaugurated, they called up DIFAS and they withdrew the law. They changed the regulation and changed the regulation so they were allowed to adopt Adam.
I understand that now they have
a whole family.
A whole family. And
after Adam, who was also a special needs baby and came out of one of the border houses, and he was a very high level of special needs. They adopted a second little girl who was an infant when they were going through the process with Adam. And DIFAS called them back and said that they found her teenage sister, and could they take them in
together?
And take it in because they would keep the kids together. And they said, okay. And the girl was like 16. And they came to live with them, and I ran into Michael and John, and I said, you know, how's it going? And he said, we're doing pretty good. He said, I forgot what the girl's name was, but she was pregnant, and she came from an abusive family situation, and she came into their house pregnant, and they made the decision that she wanted to continue the pregnancy, so they had the child, they had the baby, and so now they're raising the baby, her.
So their grandparents already.
Their grandparents. They have four kids.
That's a wonderful story. What a just a delightful to hear that. That's really something.
But they pushed and pushed and pushed with the system so that they could jointly adopt together at the same time.
And now everyone.
With one series of
right. The regulations
processes.
Are now through DIFAS.
Yeah.
If you go privately, it's different. But if through DIFAS, it's double adoption.
And gay people can adopt children now. There's no.
We always could, but it was one at a time.
Oh, okay. Well, I didn't even know.
In New Jersey.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, New Jersey was one of the first states that removed the restriction.
You know,
two
New
states
Jersey.
That you can't.
Huh?
Florida and another state you can't.
No, there's only five states where you can. Oh. There's only five states you can.
Oh?
Yeah.
Oh.
And in fact, there's only five states where they don't take your own children away from you. If you go through, like in Pennsylvania, if you go through a divorce and one parent says that the other parent is gay, you get your children taken away still.
Just as a matter of course.
Yes.
Oh, funny, I was thinking of moving to Pennsylvania.
No, don't do that.
A place like that.
Right.
Shouldn't say that because we're seen in Pennsylvania. But I mean, hopefully they'll get a little nudge and learn that, you know, there are all kinds of people and everybody's deserving of equality, no matter in families and in employment and everything.
Sure.
So there was something else that you mentioned that I thought was certainly worth discussing, and that is the differences in how New Jersey relates to gay and lesbian people and how other states, and you kind of touched on that.
New Jersey is wonderful.
Yeah, it's really,
relatively.
Really, it was. It was the first state a very long time ago, almost 25 years ago, it determined that being gay didn't automatically make you an unfit parent. It was one of the first states by executive order to grant you know, employment benefits, and we have
for state workers,
right? And our lot of the amendments to the law against discrimination that includes sexual orientation is actually one of the most broad. In some other states, it doesn't include banking or public accommodations. Public accommodations is a very big deal. It has to do with hotels and hospitals and education. And actually,
YMCA.
Education, theoretically, it also can be applied to schools. It hasn't yet been.
In what sense?
Well, schools are public. Anything that's publicly funded is a public accommodation.
Oh, okay.
So theoretically, you would, and actually, because New Jersey's non-discrimination law, there should be non-discrimination policies, in fact, in the schools. And the degree to which it's been slow to promulgate. The problem has been the legislature has, you know, sometimes been good, or the courts have been good, but the actual promulgation and the enforcement takes time.
Mm. Now, are we talking about teachers or students?
All of them.
For
teachers for employment.
Okay.
Students for public accommodation.
Harassment, anti-bullying legislation. Actually, that's another place where we're ahead of everybody else. The New Jersey just passed anti-bullying legislation that included sexual orientation and gender identity. It's one of the first in the country.
Oh, boy.
So
that's going to be fabulous.
Yes, that's very good.
Well, it's a law, and we have to see how the schools actually implement the policy.
Well, I understand now. You know, of course, many years ago, or not even that many years ago, and probably still today, a lot of people kept themselves in the closet. And it took people many years to come out, and often they had married and had children, and then they came out.
And now kids are coming out at younger and younger and younger ages.
Yeah, and so although that's good, it can also cause problems in school, hate crimes, and domestic violence.
Oh, it's terrible. Actually, again, outside of New Jersey, New Jersey's not a state where this is pervasive, but in the middle of the country, kids are coming out younger, but they're being thrown out of their house, and it's a very high rate of teenage suicide. Second cause of teenage suicide is confusion about sexual orientation.
Excuse me, Wendy, I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
I could sit and listen to this all night.
Sure.
But we're out of time.
Sure.
And I want to thank both of you
already?
For coming. Yes, it goes fast. And I want to thank both of you for coming, and this has been a fascinating discussion. And we won't let another 5 years go by before we discuss gay issues.
We can do a regular thing.
Interesting how things develop, and you know, how far along we come as we go.
Right.
So thank you both for coming, and we hope we'll see you all next time. Bye. I suppose the credits are running.
Yeah, they are.
Goodbye.